Hey everybody, thanks for joining us here on YouTube. If you like the video, make sure to mage hand us a thumbs up and subscribe to join our content guild. Also, leave a comment in that comment section down below and let us know if this episode inspired you or if you would have done it differently.
And don't forget to ring that bell so that the algorithm goblins notify you whenever we drop a new episode. You can also attune to us on your podcast platform of choice and check us out across the plains of social media.
Enjoy the episode!
Would that strike any sort of historical or religious?
Yeah, go ahead. Roll both of y'all. Roll history checks.
Six.
Yeah, you think it might be some sort of dessert, and you got a four.
Yeah,
you're certain it's a dessert.
Yeah, I've tried it at the restaurant down the street, Tasmo. It's really good, sort of like tiramisu.
Tiramisu.
Yeah, yes. But it's got a little spicier flavor.
Welcome to Dungeon Busters, your Dungeons & Dragons actual play experiment. I'm Diego, a professional dungeon master and actor.
And I'm Michael, an actor and role-playing addict. Each episode, we summon a special guest who helps us give your game inspiration one encounter at a time. We don't just play D&D,
we put it to the test.
And welcome back to another episode of Dungeon Busters. Here in the studio is myself, Diego F. Salinas, joined by my co-host,
Michael C. Hyatt.
And our special guest today,
I'm Zach Bradley. What's going on, everybody?
Yeah. How you doing today, Zach?
I'm doing amazing. This is something that I've been looking forward to for quite some time since Michael suggested the idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm ready to freaking dive in.
Yeah.
I was just going to say, Zach and I do Chicago Reacts together on YouTube. So if any of our Chicago Reacts audience is joining, thank you so much for coming to check out the podcast.
What's up, guys?
Zach, what's your experience playing Dungeons & Dragons? What are you coming from? Where are you coming from in this area?
It's always been this sort of air of mystery for me. I've always been intrigued by it. I've always been a fan of fantasy, sci-fi. One of my favorite films of all time. My favorite film of all time is The Lord of the Rings original trilogy. I consider it to be one ultimate film. I grew up always being interested in Dungeons and Dragons specifically. I feel like when I was a kid, it was always the kind of very nerdy thing. It wasn't until I sort of got towards the end of high school and into college where I started to realize, like, oh shit, a lot of people like me actually play Dungeons and Dragons, actually enjoy it. One of the coolest realizations that hit me later on, especially as I got into college and stuff, that made me want to become interested in it even more so, was the social element of
it.
Yeah. The idea of camaraderie, of getting together with some of your close and even not close friends, but
there's a beautiful like communion that happens when you're like all just around a table or like around a virtual table, whatever it might be.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So as I got more intrigued and actually becoming involved, it unfortunately made me realize more so the exclusivity of it. And it feels like no matter how interested you are in it, someone who has a casual interest in it would never know remotely where to start, where to begin, or even who to trust, right? Like, who would give me a good introductory experience into what Dungeons & Dragons is, into what it could be? So when Michael was talking about this, I was like, oh my God, this is like the ideal, this is the perfect transition into learning a little bit about it and experiencing it myself for the first time and seeing maybe if this is something that could potentially long-term be a part of my life, which is
That's cool. Well, I'm glad that you trust Diego and I to give you your first Dungeons & Dragons experience.
Well, we'll see, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see.
Well, and as you were talking about that, you know, you're talking about this sort of hurdle of entry to get into Dungeons & Dragons. So this episode I am comes from slightly from a place of spite in that I wanted to get into Dungeons & Dragons in college. I was actually at a stage combat workshop, and I remember people playing and going, that looks so cool, I want to play. And I asked if I could, and they were like, oh, we just spent like an hour and a half creating this person's character, like, we just don't really want to spend that time to build you a character too, which I both understand and also resent.
Yeah. it is crazy. Like, I mean, like, if your first experience in playing D&D is building a character, you're not going to think it's fun.
Right.
It is a lot of reading. It is like... I mean, there's a bunch of resources online that help nowadays, but like, like this wasn't always around, and there was usually one guy who knew how to like talk you through it, so you didn't have to like.
And that's right.
The book.
So our audience knows I built this character for Zach that in a way that I think is like simple but also fun. I also built him to like be a badass with the like theme of this episode. Yeah. So, and. I did roll a pretty OP character, but I thought that's kind of fun for your first Dungeons & Dragons experience. Yeah. So your character is definitely very talented, very gifted.
and until I play next time, and then I got
yeah, and then you're gonna go, wait a minute, like,
what the hell?
I can't roll everything successfully? What's happening?
I think now is a good time to transition to the topic at hand today.
Yes.
Right. Our topic for today is... Fantasy CSI.
Yes.
I'm interested in seeing how well we can get that vibe of like a crime scene investigation type of thing, like a whodunit, like get the mystery, find the clues, like Scooby-Doo this shit. And that's kind of where we're launching in today. So Fantasy CSI, just off the top, like what does that make you think of?
For me, just as long as it's not like NCIS, that's all I care.
I was gonna say. Fantasy CSI.
Yeah.
It kind of reminds me of Dimension 20 in their Fantasy High. Mm. They had a very sleuth detective like character.
Nice.
So I would say that's like an example that I think of in D&D. But I feel like it's fun to think about that as like, oh, I can see where that really expands a lot of the social encounters that you might have in a Dungeons & Dragons campaign. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, you might not want to kill all the bad guys. You might want to interrogate them. You know, like, it kind of lends itself to a different mentality, I think, when approaching the game. So I'm really excited to see kind of how that has an effect.
Yeah.
For me, and I will say kind of like as approaching it from a non-D&D background... I think when I think of fantasy or sci-fi CSI, I think of some of my favorite missions and some of my favorite video games, like Mass Effect, like some of those side quests where like you would have, you could approach it from one of two different angles and that might actually have consequences on your end game that you may or may not realize at that point in time.
Yeah.
I think it's a pretty badass topic to start my D&D career off of.
I love this idea of a fantasy CSI intrigues me so much because in a world with magic, the way you do bad things has to be different.
Right.
Just because of like also there's so many spells you can use that like if you're not careful, like your people are gonna find out that you're the guy who's been, you know, pooping in the well or whatever it is. Like, someone like scries when you're hanging out. Then without further ado, let's go ahead and head over to the Dungeon Busters lab for the actual play portion of this podcast.
Well, we definitely want to jump into some character descriptions because Zach, you're looking at a character sheet that you've never seen before.
Yes. And I'm currently changing the name of my character as well.
Oh, okay.
In love of and appreciation for being here today, I've named my character Diego Hyatt.
Oh, we're family now. Yeah.
Bonded. Amazing. Yeah, what would you like to tell us about your character? Anything that, like, looking at the character sheet that stands out or... Even like, you know, what kind of personality you're going to be bringing into this, the role play of it.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm looking at the sheet and this is my first time looking at the site and its breakdown and how it breaks down a character. So there's a couple of things sticking out to me about the character that Michael created for me.
Yeah.
And
I'm happy to dive in. Part of the reason I wanted to create the character is because creating a character can be such a hurdle. I created a more simple, like, the race is a variant human, as opposed to, you know, some of the more wild races that you can play in Dungeons and Dragons. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And looking at it, so I've got a nice +4 history. So I'm a history buff. I've got +4 to that. I've got +5 insight. I've got +8 stealth.
Yeah. And so I definitely went for a detective sleuth like mm-hmm. character. You know, I picture you dressed in like dark leathers and robes and things like that. And then I was going to ask for a couple like defining features of like, you know, sort of dark black leathers. But you do have one item that sticks out. What is that one item? Ooh. Could be an emblem or...
I want to, in honor of us watching The Naked Gun yesterday for Reacts Movies and TV, I think it would be really kind of cool if, like, he also had something that looked like a detective look. So some sort of emblem that maybe resembled, like, a tie or a bow tie or something that symbols, like, hey... I'm a detective.
Yeah.
I'm
like a
detective.
Fedora kind
yeah,
of.
Yeah, a fedora sort of thing. Like, yeah.
Suspenders.
Like yeah.
I love that. And so just for the folks at home to know, we are playing with level 3 characters today. Yeah. So welcome to the table, Diego Hyatt.
and so what is the difference between a level 3 character and a different leveled character?
So it, much like in like a video game, your character levels up the more experience they have. Okay. With each new level, they might have access to more spells. They might they might become more proficient with their weapons, be able to do more damage, get certain class features. Mm-hmm. Since you have the rogue class, you're definitely... that kind of like sneaky stabby
yes,
type of vibe.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. Definitely got that vibe.
I was going to also ask, so you've got these 2 daggers. Where do you think your character would hide your 2 daggers?
I think he's got one that's easy access. Maybe some sort of like, I'm thinking like Leon Kennedy from Resident Evil 4. He keeps one blade. Like he's got that like wrap over belt. And like the knife goes in vertically.
Yeah,
like,
I was thinking
yeah,
like,
yeah, so
like,
that's
like
cool.
From here,
pull it and down
then,
and out.
Yeah, yeah. So and then easy access for a strike too if needed. And then maybe like some sort of concealed blade.
Yeah.
I don't know if it would be in a boot, maybe even somewhere like in his cape or jacket something that's not entirely visible.
If he gets like patted down, they won't like take the blade. Like, they'll find the obvious one, but they won't take that one.
Yeah.
Nice.
Awesome. Great. I'm very excited to see you embody Diego Hyatt. Awesome. Let's kick it over to Michael. Michael, can you tell us a little bit about your character today?
Yes. I wanted to create a fun little sidekick for Diego Hyatt. I am playing Whipsy.
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 A forest gnome druid.
Oh, sick. Okay.
You know, so he's got a little chipmunk that hangs out on his, you know, very... like very earth-toned cloak and clothes.
I love that.
So he's got this, you know, little brown cloak that he wears, sort of wispy blonde hair that wraps around his face. He's got just the tiniest little mustache and like a chin strap beard. And he's, you know, following. He thinks that Diego Hyatt's a pretty cool person, pretty wise. So just following him around, helping him out where he can, kind of a sidekick, assistant character.
All right. I love that. Amazing. Great. So we got Diego Hyatt and Whipsy. and today, in our adventures, they find themselves in the free city of Ynda, one of the largest cities in the northernmost part of the Sanjib Desert. And there's been a rash of murders that have occurred in some of the neighborhoods of this large city. And you've now found yourselves, at the very least, working as consultants for the entwined Inquisitors. And it is on this early, crisp morning that you find yourselves called upon by a member of the entwined Inquisitors, for there has been another murder in Ynda. A pale-faced half-elf clad in the robes of the entwined Inquisitors offers queasy words of comfort to the young lad seated amongst the impeccably organized dried herbs, animal parts, and bottled liquids that line the narrow shelves in the front room of Garrick's apothecary shop. A dark red banner emblazoned with a golden sun serves as a curtain separating the shop's storeroom from the prying eyes of customers and passersby. A gory scene greets you as you push past the crimson curtain. Broken clay jars, shattered shelves, and idle cauldrons lay about the room, mixing with the splatters of blood that indicate not much has changed since the slaying occurred. Tucked between two narrow display cases, a bearded man with a tattooed scalp sits back in a modest rocking chair. His lifeless hands are pressed together in a prayer and held in place by the dagger thrust through both palms. A narrow barred window set high into the storeroom's back wall casts a crisscrossed beam of light onto the hardwood floors. Outside the shop, the pulse of the city steadily quickens as the denizens of Ynda begin their morning routines. As you're taking in this scene, the curtain parts once more, and Inquisitor Terrence, the half-elf that was outside, enters. The lad found outside found Marcel's body. According to him, he was here right as he opened up early, fetching a poultice for his aunt. Marcel, and he points to the dead tattooed man, ducked behind the curtain to mix some ingredients for the concoction. And that was the last time the lad saw the apothecary alive. No one came in or out. Blade through the hands, just like the other two victims this week. What do y'all think?
To me, the symbolism of the blade through both hands almost as in like some sort of prayer position is definitely the most intriguing image that stuck out to me there.
I thought so too. It was just like the other two victims we found this past week.
I'm almost curious if that would bring up some sort of like historical or religious reference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead and roll a history check. Or actually, go ahead and roll religion.
10.
10, amazing. Yeah, so looking at it, there's many ways to worship in this wide world. Hands pressed together is a common one. Though there is not a lot, not anything that you really know as sticking particularly out of like one defining religious symbolism, right? Like putting your hands together in prayer is kind of common amongst many denominations, even of various gods in this world. So there's nothing that sticks out with a 10 religion check on that.
Okay, interesting.
You could take a closer look at the blade and the body if you would like. Inquisitor Terrence says, please, do what you must. And you can see that he's getting a little green around the gills. I'm gonna go see if the lad outside is doing all right. And he pushes out past the curtains, and you think you can hear the sound of like dry heaving. From beyond.
Pleasant.
Whipsy is also feeling a little pale looking at the body, and it's if you want to look at the body, Dee, by all means, go ahead. Maybe I'll look at maybe there's some paperwork around that I can take a look at that might, and you know, point to perhaps somebody that he owed money to or something
maybe.
But you can take a look at the body. I'm going to go over there.
Maybe getting, definitely having Whipsy check out the, if there's any connection or corollary with the other victims.
You both have seen the other two crime scenes, since this is the third time the Inquisitor has called you in. The only thing that is in common, the other person that was slain was a minor noble, who also had a similar blade struck through his hands.
Okay.
And the other person seemed to be just like a lowly urchin. They found him in an alley, in that same position with his hands pressed together and the blade through them.
Okay.
You do notice that it seems like the blade that it was stuck through the hands of this victim, of Garrick, seems to be in similar like size, dimension, and material as the other two blades you saw.
Interesting.
If you'd like to take a closer look at the blade, you can definitely do that.
Yes, would look to examine the blade.
Just with a quick like look on walking up to the body and looking at the blade, you can see that it's a platinum dagger that holds Marcel's hands together. I switched the names around of this guy. The dead guy is called Marcel.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, the platinum dagger holds Marcel's hands together. Mm-hmm. And
think you see words inscribed on the ceremonial blade, but you can't read them because it's
like,
stabbed through sets of two hands.
So need to pry the hands apart from the blade.
Yeah, would you like to pull the dagger out?
Yes.
Great, yeah, you hold the hands together and pull the blade out. The hands fall limply onto his lap. And you can see that the inscription reads on the blade in common, "For 30 years honorable service," and is accompanied by a golden sun emblem.
So that definitely sounds to me information. Now, what's the significance of the blade, this symbol? Is it something that we've seen before? You said that the blade, the dagger was similar, at least it appeared to me, to the previous victims.
Pulling it out now, it is identical. The other ones also had this same inscription followed by the emblem of the golden sun.
You said for 30 years service?
For 30 years honorable service, correct.
Honorable service, too.
Huh. Interesting.
So that would maybe imply some sort of maybe military type service I know that we did the religion check already, but maybe even some sort of service pertaining to religious service of some sort.
Go ahead and roll a history check. Right. History buff.
Six.
this inscription, it's very uniform and neat. It looks like it was very intentionally carved into the blade of the ceremonial dagger, mm-hmm. not like it was quickly like scratched on. Mm-hmm. But you're not really able to discern if it's religious or militaristic in nature.
Gotcha. Okay. I would say maybe also looking to see other details of the scene. Was something taken, for example, from the apothecary? Was something from the shop also damaged? Or were there any other injuries to the apothecary? Like, is there anything else about there?
Yeah, go ahead and roll a medicine check for me, please.
Okay, 21.
Oh, amazing, yeah. So with your 21 medicine check, you're pulling back on Marcel's clothing and kind of looking around his area, and you notice that he has, like, bruises all over his body. You can surmise that he was repeatedly struck with a blunt object before he died. There's bruising and redness around his neck, which suggests he was strangled with a rope or other form of, like, garrote and died from the lack of air. With your 21 medicine check, you also are able to locate small needle-like punctures on Garrick's exposed neck. The area around those small wounds retains a little swollen redness. And you can also tell that Garrick was alive when the blade was struck through his hands, but that he didn't struggle.
So, but the official, like, cause of death was asphyxiation?
It looks to be like that, yes.
Okay. Interesting. But the blade was put in while he was still alive.
The blade was stabbed through both of his hands, locking him in that prayer position while he was alive. No sign of struggle, like it's a very clean entry, in and out, just like straight through.
Gotcha. And so was the, also, so the apothecary was in a position, you said, in between, like he was kind of pressed in between two, what was it? Like
display cases. Display he's like cases. Sitting in like a rocking chair. Okay. That's like, there's like shelves of ingredients and like mortars, pestles and whatnot. He's this rocking chair in between these two display cases. That's where his body was.
Gotcha. Is there any sign of like, of a struggle or a fight? Like any...
Yeah.
Potions knocked over?
The room has been wrecked in like a readily evident struggle. Like, there is, like, stuff knocked over, things are, like, smashed all over the floor, like, some shelves have been broken.
Mm-hmm. How big was the apothecary? Was he a pretty sizable monster?
Yeah, six foot guy, bald, but rather thin, not muscular.
Okay.
But, you know, he looks like he works here alone for the most part, and there's some, you know, heavy stuff that presumably he moves around without much issue.
Okay. Okay. So it would have had to be a pretty sizable foe then as well to be able to take down the individual, also get them seated in the chair like that. If there are several bruises and several blunt forces issued. And yeah, okay. Interesting.
Whipsy, is there anything that's calling your attention, something that you might want to take a closer look at in this room? You had mentioned earlier kind of just a general investigation check of the room.
Yeah, I guess I was looking for motive of, like, looking through paperwork, seeing, like, is there any names that stick out that look like, you know, he had any overdue bills?
Yeah, or... go ahead and roll a investigation check to see if you could find some sort of ledger.
That is a 19.
19, amazing. With that 19, you notice that there is a noticeable blood smear from what appears to be a box being pushed under this window in the back wall of the room. Let's see what else you see.
It looks like someone may have darted out the window.
The window, as you're looking up at it, yeah, it looks like something was pushed to, like, under the window, but the window is maybe about the length of a man's forearm across and about, like, only three times as wide.
Okay.
So it is, even, unless you're, like, a small creature, even, like, maybe a halfling would have had, or a gnome would have trouble squeezing out of it. It is also a grated iron bars on the window, so it's not just, like, open.
Okay, so so really it would be hard to get out.
Yeah.
It really isn't an escape.
Unless, doesn't appear to be. Okay. Not at least you don't notice that the bars have been, like, meddled with or broken in any way.
Okay.
With that investigation check, you also do, as you're looking around, you manage to locate a hidden cupboard in the wall behind some loose stones.
What'd you find, Richard?
Inside, you find a leather satchel with all the makings of a poisoner's kit. You also find various illicit ingredients, a stand meant for the display of a small blade, and a ledger of names and ailments. As you're leafing through this, among this list, you notice the name of the lad who's outside. His aunt's name is on this. You mentioned her before, Aunt Roji.
Okay.
And her entry is accompanied by a recipe next to her name.
So maybe our apothecary wasn't as innocent as it appears on face value. Or maybe we should talk to Aunt Roji.
Yeah, we could talk to Aunt Roji. Maybe we should talk... What was the boy's name again?
Yes, the lad. You had not gotten his name. You only heard him speaking of his aunt as entered into the crime scene. But he is still in the front room with the Inquisitor Terrence.
Well, I found this ledger. Dee, maybe we should go and talk to the... kid, maybe he mentioned his aunt. That name is on this list. Maybe we should talk to him and see. Was she getting medicine? Or I mean, this seems
to something else. Yeah, let's talk to this lad.
All right. You guys are able to push through the curtains. You can see Inquisitor Terrence, like, blotting his forehead. He's still looking a little pale. Uh-huh. But he's, like, kind of just weakly, like, patting the lad on the arm, who's kind of just sitting there, like, with his eyes wide. He seems a little stunned. Seeing you all come out of the storeroom, he stands up and says, what did y'all find out?
Well, we found something, but can I talk to the boy there?
Yeah. Lad, stand up straight. Answer any questions they might have. They are here on the guidance of the Inquisitors. And the kid, he's, like, probably, like, 15, 16. He's a human boy with mousy brown hair. And he's got like a little scar kind of coming down his left cheek. Yeah, is there anything I can do? I didn't see much, but ask and I can speak.
Well, what's your name?
My name's Darren.
Oh, Darren. Nice to meet you, Darren. Was your aunt receiving medications from the apothecary?
Aye, sir. The corruption in my Aunt Roji's arm took a turn for the worse overnight. She's been struggling with it for some weeks. It seems like the wound won't heal. We'd run out of Marcel's poultice, so I came here before first light for more. I arrived just as Marcel was unlocking the door.
Oh, so you were... Wait a minute. You were here when Marcel...
Was found?
Was found unlocking the door, and then things happened after that?
The Inquisitor Terrence speaks something that says, yes, Derek, you're the one who found the body.
Oh, you found the body, okay.
And the lad continues, yeah, I saw Marcel. He disappeared into his storeroom to mix the ingredients for my aunt's poultice. It shouldn't have taken more than a couple of minutes, but it'd been dead silent for about 30, so curiosity got the better of me, and I went to see what was taking so long. That's when I found him. Like this, and he holds his hands together in that prayer position.
I sort of lean into Diego Hyatt's ear and go,
how is it dead silent in that room? It looked like it was trashed to all hell.
Can you explain the state of the room that you found it in?
Yeah, I mean, he points around like, well, Marcel does like to keep a tidy shop, though I was surprised when I saw potions and ingredients strewn all over the floor. It looked like there'd been some kind of struggle or fight there. There's no way anyone could have gone in or out of the storm room without me noticing. As soon as I found the body, I hollered out in the street for help. It wasn't long before Inquisitor Terrence arrived with y'all in tow.
What? And you didn't hear anything?
I didn't hear nothing. I was sitting here just working on my whittling, and he like holds up like a little like a bear that he's just like carving at it, like a little piece of driftwood.
Yeah. What do you know what is normally in the poultice that your aunt gets?
If I knew what was in it, I would be making it myself and not paying good old Marcel here for his good kindness.
What is the rate that he usually charges? Mostly I just want to see like the ingredients that are on the ledger, like, would it make sense that it would, like, I guess I'm curious if this kid did it, because he was there, or just outside the door and didn't hear anything.
Right.
So I'm trying to see, like, make sure that the potion, like, what his aunt is getting makes sense for what's on the ledger.
Give me a medicine check, okay. As you're kind of comparing this, reading, like, taking a closer look at the recipe in this ledger.
Ooh, that's a 15.
15, amazing. You surmise that the recipe, when concocted, is known for, like, a lot of the ingredients in there are known for their healing properties, good for, like, rooting out infection and healing wounds.
Okay.
But it seems that this recipe has had an addition added to it with some corrupting factors that in your experience with that medicine check you believe are meant to prolong the corruption in Aunt Roji's arm. Ooh, and as you're kind of looking through the ledger, you see that there are other names of people with like recipes next to their name. And there is like a common theme of like this stuff will like make you feel like a little bit better, but it's not gonna cure you.
Ooh, interesting. How long has your aunt been taking this?
About 3 weeks ago, she sliced her arm working on the construction for for her job. She's a mason.
And how did you get your scar?
Oh, this old thing. Just playing with some kids. Used to play a lot in the streets when we were younger, when we had the time for such things. And don't play around with a broken glass bottle. That's all I'll say.
Does it look like his scar? Well, it's a scar, not like
yeah, it's a scar.
It's okay. A scar. Have you ever received any medicine from the apothecary?
Well, I had a cough last winter that it did take a little bit of a doing to get rid of it, but I was healed up in quite a short order after I came in and saw Marcel, and he gave me his. His tinctures.
If this Darren didn't do it, Ramon came in around.
Are there any other? While I was in the room, or maybe popping back in there, does it look like there are any other exits that could be taken advantage of?
With that, with your previous investigation check that led you to find the hidden hidden cupboard. You did not find any other sign of egress or entrance. It seems, and it's a small shop enough as it is. Like, you come in, there's like the front area where there's like kind of loose ingredients that people can kind of buy a la carte. And in the back is like kind of presumably where Marcel has been like kind of grinding up and like he mixes everything together when he needs. leads to. But it's a small, and there's like just the front door to get into the main shop, and then the curtain, just the thin red curtain with the golden sun on it that leads into that back storeroom.
Right. The only thing I would say, Whipsy, about like as far as if you're at all intrigued by the suspicion behind Darren being there, is there were three other murders used by this with the same weapon, right? So what would lead us to believe that the 15-year-old could potentially be responsible for more murders?
Both of you go ahead and give me an insight check for Darren.
Yeah, that's a great... I want to get a read on this guy.
Yes. And that's what insight is for.
Yeah, so gotcha. Insight is the catch-all skill for like kind of reading someone's like mood, motives, okay. or intention.
Okay, sweet.
So,
okay.
What did you get?
I rolled a 17.
17, amazing.
I rolled an 18.
18, amazing. Yeah, between the both of y'all, kind of having looked at his like facial features, he's been making really good eye contact. He seems earnest. It doesn't. It seems like Darren is speaking truthfully everything that he has said.
Yeah.
Do you know if he happened to finish the poultice before he perished? Because my aunt really needs it. Her arm's not looking too good.
But if there's stuff in the...
Well, Darren, I would say you should go to a different apothecary.
Yes. Yes.
Marcel, he's the one that takes care of everyone in this neighborhood. Obviously we're gonna need to go to a different one now because he's dead, but...
Well, there's some interesting ingredients here that, are not typical.
What are you saying?
I'm saying I don't know that his intentions were... just to heal.
Inquisitor Terran says, out with it, Whipsy! What do you mean?
Well, there's some ingredients in here that would continue any sort of
ailments.
Corruption going on here. And, well, I don't know why the apothecary, Marcellus, would be doing such things.
So this medicine man was keeping his patients sick?
Yes.
Interesting.
I still don't know who murdered him. Some sort of... the other bodies, were there other things that they were doing that were not as morally or ethically bad?
I will say, I did forget to say one thing that you found in the cupboard.
Okay.
You did see that scratched into the stone of that cupboard, that hidden cupboard, were two words. Remember Teosmo.
Would that strike any sort of historical or religious?
Yeah, go ahead. Both of y'all roll history checks.
Six.
Yeah, you think it might be some sort of dessert. And you got a four?
Yeah.
You're certain it's a dessert.
Yeah. I've tried it at the restaurant down the street, Teosmo. It's really good. Sort of like tiramisu.
Tiramisu.
Yeah, yes. But it's got a little spicier flavor. it's quite good.
Nothing hits like a Teosmo and a cappuccino.
Yes. Oh, maybe we should get that afterwards. Yes. Anyway, I almost want to go back in there and see if there's somebody hiding in there. Like that box, looking in that box.
Yes.
And just seeing if something seems hidden.
I would also maybe want to re-examine the puncture wounds on his neck.
Yeah.
One more time to maybe see, because... My first thought was, oh, is that like a puncture, like an injection? Like, well, could he have been poisoned with the swelling around his neck with the small puncture wounds? So I would maybe want to re-examine that one more time as well.
Yeah, so you'll go ahead and roll me another investigation check, please.
Okay.
Whipsy, you said you were going to check out the box that's under the window?
Yeah.
You kind of pry it open, and it's just got like clay pots and whatnot set in hay and other like wood chips and whatnot to presumably keep them from like moving around too much or breaking the transportation.
Okay.
What it did kind of seem interesting is when you stood up on the box and you looked out the window, it gave you a fairly unobstructed view into the narrow alley behind the wall and up and through a smoke-stained window from a burnt-out apartment building across that alley.
So they would have good visual on the apothecary shop.
Oh, yeah.
Go and check that out. See if they saw anything.
you know, being a sleuth in fantasy D&D, I guess part of me thinks, well, and being a druid, perhaps this entity can shapeshift into a smaller entity, or I've heard of people being able to teleport short distances, so it might be worth seeing if they're in that room. If it's not too far away, maybe even could have teleported to the room.
Yes. Or, like I said, maybe someone could have witnessed or heard something from that window if they're close enough.
Yes. And you wanted to see if you could find more information about
the... Yes, on the puncture wounds on the neck. Yeah. I rolled a 5 for my investigation.
5 investigation. You're kind of looking around, treading a lot of the ground that that Whipsy has already tread. Mm-hmm. And you don't find anything else that sticks out.
Gotcha. All right, well, let's go investigate the...
Yes.
Great. As you exit out of the shop, you notice Darren the lad. He says, well, I'm going to go see if I can secure some poultice from another apothecary for my aunt. Appreciate y'all's service. If there's anything else y'all need, may the gods be with you.
Yeah, make sure that you leave your address with...
Absolutely. The Inquisitor knows where to find me.
And be very careful.
Thank you. Inquisitor Terran says, I'm going to stay here and make sure no one moves anything, touches anything. Hurry back, though. And great, yeah, you guys are able to kind of go around the block and up the alley. And this, you're standing kind of at the base of this, like, apartment building in the alley behind the storeroom that you saw through the window. Looking up at the apartment building, it's, like, burnt out. It's, like, a fire has happened here maybe, like, a decade ago. Okay. And just the building is still here. There's, like, smoke and soot stains on the brick and the little couple windows that are there. So nothing impedes you from entering and ascending and trying to go up to that room. And as you ascend...
Perhaps be wary.
Yes, we don't know what kind of structural damage there could be.
Mm-hmm. And let me see. In a third floor room, you find a makeshift lookout nest with a direct view through the storeroom's narrow window. This is an abandoned, empty building. But you notice that there are words carved into the burnt wall next to a dingy bedroll. Remember Teozmo.
There it is again, Whipsy.
Remember Teozmo.
Somehow I'm not thinking that this guy's...
Are there any signs of someone being there recently?
Investigation check, please.
18.
18, amazing. And what did you get?
I rolled an 8.
Yeah, so you're kind of just like looking around, and you overlook the dried bloodstains that Whipsy is able to see on the burnt out floor. Whipsy, you go above and beyond too, and you lift up the bedroll and look under it, where you find a hollow section of floorboard. Move that out of the way, and you are able to pull out a small looking glass as well as some, you know, notes with arcane writings and sigils. It looks to be like workings of a spell. The first spell referenced in these notes seems to be able to teleport its caster 30 feet to a place they can see. This is the Misty Step spell.
Yes.
You've also found notes that suggest that whoever had access to these notes was also practicing a spell that would silence a large area. This is the effects of the silence spell.
Good work, Whipsy.
Clears Darren's name.
And describes how the events could have actually happened.
Yeah, so we know someone escaped, and it was silent. Do we have any clues as to where they might have gone?
Go ahead and give me another investigation.
14?
24.
Oh, nice. Yeah, Diego Hyatt, you are looking around, and you can surmise that whoever left these bloodstains on the floor doesn't seem to have any intention of coming back. Room is pretty bare. There's no food. There's no water. Mm-hmm. The bedroll is dingy enough. You can even see that maybe some sections of it have been torn off in, like, large strips. It is, like, quite a barren little perch that whoever was here has left behind.
It was a temporary stay. Well, so clearly the apothecary was a very distinct target.
the...
Yes. For this Tarasmo, or remember Tarasmo, and this sun. I guess we could explore what Tarasmo is.
Yeah, could
we? I'm hoping to find some sort of tracks, though.
Looking around, even with Diego Hyatt's 24 roll, there's no tracks leading out of this room. No blood.
So you could have teleported again.
Honestly, Diego Hyatt, you can surmise that whoever was in here probably was injured when they arrived, and that would explain the torn strips of the bedroll.
Oh, shoot. I was going to say, maybe Darren saw someone leave this building. Because they didn't see anyone enter or leave the apothecary, but they didn't mention anything about the door next door.
So for reference, so this would be like, this apartment building shares a back alley with it, so it would be like...
A different street even.
Yeah. So according to Darren, his story is that he was waiting for the poultice to finish, took a long time, came, saw the body, ran out into the front street, out the front door of the apothecary, called out for help, and that's when the Inquisitor came with people. This is like a back alley that's like on the other side of the storeroom.
Right? I mean, I guess we could look for blood, drops of blood on the street.
Yeah, if we know that he's bleeding, there could be a blood trail elsewhere. Or I was gonna say, maybe we could investigate that. Was it a page you said that the spell was on? Could we maybe find out where that book could have come
from? Yeah.
Even
wrapped into your previous investigation check, it looks like it's something that was torn out of another book and had its own like markings and like annotations added along to it.
Gotcha. Okay.
Okay.
So, were either of you wizards, you would be able to, or if you did not already know these spells,
right?
There's enough notes here to like copy them into your own spell book, should you want to.
So we might be dealing with a wizard.
Are there any like a bird's nest roosting in this burnt out place, or perhaps a rodent scurrying by?
Yeah, go ahead and roll a nature check. Nature or perception?
I'll do nature. Actually, I could have done perception.
Ooh, that's a 20.
Nice. You see there is a little hole in the wall, and you can see like a couple of cockroaches are hanging out.
Ooh, some cockroaches.
In this area. Like, you're still like in the burnt out perch.
I see what you're doing on the side there.
So I kind of want to cast... I don't know if this works on cockroaches, but I'll leave it to DM's your choice. I was going to cast Speak with Animals.
Yeah, it's an animal. Talk to it.
All right. Has there been a being living in here, in this space that isn't normally here?
As you approach the cockroaches, they scatter. But as you tune your speech into the language of beasts, and you tune your ears to it, you can hear the birds twittering outside. Their calls change from sweet little chirps into like quite derogatory, like cat calls.
Oh wow!
The cockroaches that have scattered, you can hear them all say, "Flee, flee, big one, big one!" But as your language matches up with theirs, they start to kind of tentatively poke their antenna out. Food bringer, food bringer.
Yeah. I reach in my bag for like a crumb of bread or something like that, and like crumble it on a little shelf for them to snack on.
Seven cockroaches come scurrying out of this whole food bringer.
Yes, my name is Whipsy, bringer of food. Has there been a previous bringer of food here, or someone you noticed?
There has been a food bringer. Food. Not much food, not good food.
What kind of food?
Mainly moldy, delicious moldy cheeses and rank meats. But that food bringer did not share as easily as you do. Food bringer. He squished one of my brothers for touching his food.
Ask if there was any Tiasmo.
Do you know Tiasmo?
Yeah, because remember we're convinced it's a dessert.
Was
right
it Tiasmo?
Is Tiasmo food?
I think so. I'm pretty sure it's a dessert. No, okay.
No sweets here, just rank meats and cheeses.
No sweet desserts.
no sweet desserts.
Food bringer gone. Hopefully food bringer don't come back.
I'm sorry to hear about your brother.
It's all right. I have 3,000 of them.
Yes. Well, that's good. Family should stick together.
Family. You can see, like, all the cockroaches are, like, rubbing antennae with each other. A couple of them are, like, flitting around about each other.
Whipsy's mustache becomes a little more animated to, like, the movement of the antenna.
I love that.
Meanwhile, Diego's just, like, on the outside, just, like, waiting, just checking his watch.
Okay. Any recollection of when they left or what direction they might have gone in? The food bringer?
Food bringer. When the light had burnt out the darkness, food bringer left. Us fellows like the darkness.
Okay.
It makes us feel safe. Not often we can come out in the daylight for a food bringer, like such as yourselves, to not attack us.
So it was during the day. Okay. It was very recent.
Cockroaches all in unison say, the food is finished! Time to fornicate! And they all, like, kind of, like, squat, like, thank you, food bringer, and they go into, like, the cracks
Have
of
fun.
The wall.
Okay. Well, yes, I mean, that was helpful. I mean, we know that there was a person here. Yes, perhaps we should look at the street to look for blood.
More dry blood.
Yeah.
All right, move to street.
Great, go ahead, roll an investigation check in the alley.
There's droplets of blood in this burnt out...
In the perch, yeah.
In the perch, right?
Yes. Was it droplets or was it dried already?
It was dried. Not like bone dry, but like it's not going to smear around a lot more.
So it may have happened during the attack.
Yeah.
And then he got injured from that, so quickly wrapped up his leg... from the bed sheets or from the torn up bed. So yeah, it's a fresh wound.
So I'm inclined to wild shape.
Yeah.
Into like a dog.
And so and you
so
could,
I could
you
smell could... the blood
sure.
and try to track the blood.
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe I can sniff this guy out.
So all wild shape and all my body sort of starts to undulate and contort into a dog. But being a gnome, my size doesn't change. So I'm picturing like a corgi size, mastiff, or like bloodhound. So I'm just like
amazing,
tiny little dog, but with this like huge schnoz that is going to try to sniff this what we think might be a wizard out.
Yeah, go ahead and roll a. Perception check with advantage due to your keen hearing and smell.
Yes.
Feature as a dog.
That's a nice one. Yes.
You are sniffing around the alley, and you can feel the blood wafting in faintly from the storeroom. You can't really smell the one that's like three stories above you.
Yeah.
But there you aren't finding any fresh blood in this alley. You do smell, you can kind of get, like, would be able to get a better smell at the stuff in the storeroom inside if you wanted to go back around and into the storeroom. But from here, you can tell at least that there are two distinct scents.
Okay.
Mixing in amongst all, like, the herbs and, like, spices and mm-hmm. whatnot that the apothecary would use.
Can I go around to the front of the burnt out building and
yeah.
see if, like... there's a trail going away.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. With that 20, you smelling around, it does smell like a lot of people coming through here, but you haven't really like locked on to like the one single smell. You'd have to go to the storeroom to kind of like get that one imprinted into yourself. And
yeah,
then, like,
I can go back around. I'll go back to the storeroom.
Yeah, yeah. Inside the storeroom, you are overwhelmed by like just all the different smells that there are, all the different ingredients. But the smell of blood rises above them all, and you can smell, after sniffing up on Marcel a little bit, you're able to kind of identify his smell and his scent in the room. Terrence the Inquisitor is kind of looking around like at you as like you're like a little dog walking around this like corpse, and you are able to latch onto a couple of blood splatters that don't match up with Marcel's blood, Marcel's scent, or any of the other scents that are here. This is a strong scent. It also seems that whoever left behind this, it almost smells like saffron. That's what like this other scent smells like. They were here for a while, and you can get a very strong sense of them, like on the rocking chair as well. You may think that this person might have spent a night here,
maybe
based on the strength of the smell.
Maybe waiting for him.
Oh, maybe. Okay.
Meanwhile, I will say that I'm still in the alley, and
yeah,
I'm doing an additional investigation check.
Yeah.
I rolled an 18.
18, amazing. Yeah, looking around, you don't notice any, like, scuff marks leading up on the wall, leading up to the window. You don't really notice anything, like, out of the ordinary in this alley. Certainly no blood or bodies or, you know, discarded weapons or the like. It seems like a pretty bare alley, you know, no real leads there.
Okay. Can I track, like, the saffron smell if I head out?
Yeah. As you're heading out, the saffron smell doesn't lead, it is not present in the front room.
Okay.
In the front of the store. And by the time you like exit the threshold, like it is not present in this area of the street here.
Okay. So maybe I'll turn back around and see, does it look like there, yeah, is some sort of hiding place where someone might have, I guess, with the spell book, would I know if that spell could be used more than once? Like, do I get the impression that they teleported in and out, or that...
That's up to your impression.
Okay.
I will say that you know that, you know, you're a spellcaster yourself.
That's
you know
true.
That there are
cast spells
some spells that
once.
you have access to many times a day, but you also do know that you have a limited pool of magical energy to draw from.
Yeah.
As you were kind
of
looking
and
around,
because of the fact that you smelled the saffron in there that's been there for a while in the rocking chair, it does suggest that the perpetrator was in there waiting for the apothecary.
Or is it these there for a while?
Right.
Yeah. So maybe I'll still look to see if there's some sort of hiding spot that I can find.
Roll investigation with advantage to see if you can like smell some sort of hiding spot.
Yeah, where that, like anywhere else that scent is particularly strong. Yeah.
Said investigation with advantage.
Yeah.
Does that just mean you roll two die and it's the best of?
Yeah.
Exactly. At disadvantage, you'd roll two and take the lower of the two.
That is an eight.
Eight. Yeah, you look, you smell around, you even are able to kind of loop back around to the entrance of the burnt out building. You don't really, you smell a faint saffron there that's already kind of fading as more people are kind of bustling through the city. The city's kind of going about its day now. It's still early morning, but people are moving around. No saffron smell in the alley. The saffron smell seems to be mainly concentrated in that, in the perch and in the storeroom. No other hidden.
So we're knowing that the same person was there. Okay.
How long ago were the previous two murders that took place?
Terrence, he's like kind of walked up, like he's in the storeroom with with the corgi, and he like kind of walks up to the stands up on the box and looks out the window at you, and is like, the other body we found it 2 days ago, and we found the second body the day before.
Okay, I'm wondering if it would be worthwhile to go revisit those scenes.
To see if that smell is there,
it would guarantee that it's the same
entity.
Yes, that would be committing, because then we could connect motive to from previous crimes. Because right now the one thing that we are definitely unsure of is we don't know what the motives are.
Well, I think we already know they're connected, because we know that the dagger's the same. We know that the symbol's the same.
Right.
So, I guess we could go to see if it's the same person or if it's like an organization rather than just an individual.
Yeah, because I'm thinking of it almost from like a criminal minds perspective. If we know what the motive of the perpetrator is, we can maybe even start to scout out who future victims might be.
I'm gonna pop out of wild shape form.
Yeah.
By our Inquisitor, and just say, Do you know what Tarasmo means?
Teosmo, yeah, and then you kind of lead him. He's like, "What?" And they lead him back to the and show him the
etching in the stone.
Yeah, and you can see that in this like hidden cupboard, there's that "Remember Teosmo" etched into it. That's where you found the poisoner's kit, a stand meant to for the display of a small dagger, and the ledger with Aunt Roji's name. Teosmo, let's see if he does know. Can someone roll a d20 for me?
Go for it, Zach.
14. No, Teosmo, I'm not sure. Doesn't ring a bell. Certainly not anything around here, at least, or nothing that I know of.
Is there a place we can go to get information on Teosmo?
There's the local library.
Yeah,
we could go to the
library. But wait, before you all leave the scene, I need to know. Run it back for me. What happened here? What are the leads? Where do we go from here? This is the third murderer in a week. So what happened?
We know that what we presume to be a wizard killed Marcel, strangled and bludgeoned him, and then stabbed him through the hands before he died, with the dagger that was in the nook. Because there's the place for the dagger to be
stood. Yeah.
So something to think about, Inquisitor, were there stands for other daggers? Did it seem like the individuals owned the daggers who were stabbed previously?
I mean, we didn't look about it. We didn't know to look for it at the time.
Right.
Yeah.
30 years of service. So what did Marcel, if it was Marcel's dagger that he was killed with, what service do we not know about Marcel?
Yeah, is there anything that we can look for to like understand what the honorable years of service could mean? Or do we think it's...
Is there anything you want to look at to try and...
Yeah, I guess I'm looking at
focus in on, or just generally like kind of... No, just
I guess I would look
means.
At like, is there like a keepsakes box that looks like...
Perception check.
I'm assuming the 30 years of service is tied to Teosmo.
Yeah. And that golden sun symbol too. Is that the same symbol that's on that curtain that draws across?
It is.
Okay.
Curtain. Oh, okay. So Teosmo.
Yeah, so there's a golden sun in the blade.
Okay.
And there's also, as you noticed, Diego Hyatt, there is a golden sun on this crimson banner.
Yes,
that's the curtain between the storeroom and the store.
So, maybe this entity, this wizard, is killing people of Teosmo. People who serve Teosmo.
We need to find out exactly who.
We know that they teleported out to that perch in the burnt-out building next door, Inquisitor. And
but also proceeded to be
they are injured.
They are injured.
So they might be going somewhere for medical assistance.
But it have to be close by, because if this happened recently as well, and he's injured, we know that the wizard couldn't have gotten far, especially if he's devoid of magic power from the transport.
Yes, I mean, we don't know that for sure.
But then how did the lad not hear the commotion?
There was a silence spell. Silence spell as well.
So we know that the lad... It makes sense that the lad didn't hear the commotion.
So
there's no reason to suspect Darren then, is there?
No, not at all. But the wizard would be not only injured and weak, but likely very devoid of magic power if they cast the silence spell and the transport.
Yes.
So the wizard can't be that far.
I would think close.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, we've got our leads. It certainly sounds like we need to find out. What is Teosmo?
We could go to the library and research Teosmo. Cause
of death?
Strangling, right?
Yes. Asphyxiation.
But there were some puncture wounds that were very interesting.
How long is that?
And he was poisoning people.
Yes.
Interesting. So it wasn't like a great apothecary.
So maybe somebody who's defying what Teosmo means.
Yeah,
somebody's taking like religious...
Teosmo, is it a place, a person, a...
Well, that is what we need to find out. So
serving Teosmo makes me think it's an organization or a god.
Yes.
But I'm not familiar. That's my guess.
These are some very strong leads.
It also could be a dessert, but I'm thinking that less and less.
Great work.
Yeah.
Diego and Whipsy. I hope we don't have to work closer together, but if there's anything more you find about this case, I'd be very interested to hear your musings on it.
Yes, and in the meantime, have all of your local fellow Inquisitors and Enforcers be on alert, because this wizard could be close by.
Yes. Yeah, no, I was gonna say, let's go check out the library.
Yes.
To the library! Awesome. Well, thanks, folks. Y'all just listened to our CSI Fantasy actual play portion of this podcast. Now let's go ahead and kind of talk about it. Let's see what we liked, what we didn't like, what worked, what didn't work. But right at the top of this, I'd just love to ask both of y'all, what is something that struck you in this encounter?
It was surprisingly easy to like imagine and visualize, and I loved the improvisational format. Like, it took me a little while to kind of like warm up and realize kind of what was actually going on, but then it's kind of empowering. Like, it definitely makes me realize too, like, the power of a good DM that can actively lead you through the campaign and the story properly, because I could see how, like, as a newbie working with other newbies, this could be like very awkward, could stagnate at times for sure.
Especially a mystery thing. Yeah. A mystery is a very challenging thing for a newer DM.
Yes. Yeah. Because I was also like, especially in the beginning, I was definitely looking to Michael to kind of help and lead like a little bit as far as like, and then getting comfortable with the actual investigation stuff, it became a lot easier and more enjoyable too, as we were kind of making our way through the scene.
Yeah, it was definitely fun. I definitely was trying to give you some leeway of like, oh yeah, you should check out the body, it's making me queasy, and like trying to do some story stuff to be like, no, I want to give you the opportunity to investigate some of this stuff and check it out, which is really fun. I love this sort of mystery clue finding thing, because like it gives you like, I imagine, looking behind the curtain, that you have very specific things that you have sort of planted in the scene for us to find, and it's sort of cool. How do we find those things?
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's I feel like that is the nice thing from a DM's perspective of like, cool, I'm going to have these things that are definite like clues, and maybe some things that aren't as cluey, but like, I mean, yeah, it's just like every detail was important. And I feel like that was from, you know, the symbol on the curtain to, I loved the saffron smell that you invented, because I'm sure you weren't expecting a sniff-based check.
No, I was great. Not. Or talking to the cockroaches. I always love like speak with animals, because I love getting into like the mindset of like different creatures. Like, a cockroach is gonna view the world so much more differently than a bird or a bear might.
When the what did you say, the light burned away the darkness or something like that. I was like, that's so good. I loved that so much. So it was really fun. But I think what is helpful, and I'm curious to see, Zach, how you felt about this being a new player, is like, we had a very defined space to play in.
Yes.
That felt very helpful to, like, I can picture this, like, these two buildings very clearly.
That was actually coincidentally going to be my next note, was I thought what made it a very fun kind of, in my opinion too, like, very ultra interactive first time of doing this, was the fact that yes, it was a mystery, but the spaces were so well defined, where even though in our three heads that space is a very different overall and visually, but the way that it was described, I truly felt very immersed in the space with you, and that definitely helped too. Like, as a DM, did you feel like there was kind of a lot of overlap there in questioning, or a lot of kind of going back to things? I felt very like, I never felt like retracing our steps would make us stagnate or make us uncomfortable, or like there, it didn't feel like there was a lot of stuff that you necessarily needed to repeat, or so in that sense the space was like very well defined and visualized.
Yeah, I mean, definitely, like, planning this encounter out, like, and getting to think of this, like, how to do this. How to make this so that if you fail one check, it's not just going to be like, great, you hit a dead end, it's over. You have to have this kind of, like, Russian nesting doll of things. Like, you find the, you found the secret cupboard, and that's where you got the answer to the this, like, side mystery. Like, why is Aunt Roji's arm still bad? And why would someone target this, like, apothecary who's not what he seems? But, and then within that, there's another mystery. Like, what is Remember Teosmo? What is this poisoner's kit, etc.? There was definitely a sense, as I was developing this, that I really wanted to, and I actually drew a lot of inspiration from, because I always do a lot of research for these things, even when I'm just writing for my friends. I found a Reddit post that referenced, because I just looked up how to do fantasy CSI, and I found this Reddit post that referenced Dungeon Magazine number 129, and we can probably link this in the show notes down the line. But it is, it's this, like, old, like, magazine that was being published in, like, 2005, and it has this really wonderful, mystery adventure, that actually overlapped a little bit with, the initial, like, kind of premise that excited me, which was someone is killing these people who maybe aren't as good as the rest of society. The rest of society thinks they
are. Sort of a vigilante assassin.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And let me, I want to make sure I give credit here to this thing that I use for reference and inspiration. It is called Murder in Oakbridge by Kurlianchik, Ramón, Pérez, Robert Lazzaretti. And it's like designed for like a, it's like an urban Eberron campaign setting thing. But it is like a murder mystery. And it really clued me in into how to make a crime scene that has a lot of threads you can pull. Because that was very important to me. That, like, you weren't just going to hit a dead end if you failed a check. Like, you guys rolled, like, really bad on, like, finding out what Teosmo was.
Consistently.
Consistently, yeah. Which, do y'all want to know what it is? Because this is one of the things I love about this podcast is because when I run a campaign, like, I never tell my players, oh, like, you missed, like, this hidden treasure behind this door.
But so, we get to do that here.
So, Teosmo, had you gotten a 25 on your history check, you would have known that Teosmo was a small village in a region to the northeast. History remembers it as a den of spies and traitors that was raised by the Creatorian army as they sought to quell civil uprisings in the area 30 years back.
So a little like Tiananmen Square.
Little bit,
or
yeah.
Like, or that sort of like remember the, or remember the Alamo.
Yeah, exactly.
With American pedagogy or pedagogy. But that's so interesting. And that adds like, not, it's so interesting to like, that fact is very specific and fleshes out such a different narrative than like what I have when it's like, oh, it's some organization or some god. Right. But that's still so vague. Right. But then you get into this specific organization and it's like, oh, this is somebody who's like, feels like they have a vendetta against these people because like, or they were part of this organization. So they're hunting down people that used to be part of this organization, and that's all they have is the dagger. And it's like, oh, all of a sudden these pieces come together. But then you go to the library and you discover that, and it, like you
just find a mystery at the heart of the mystery.
And you're like, oh, okay. So now we need to start tracking down these people because they're in danger, but also maybe they're shady people. So.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, there was a sense of morality to it too that I was looking forward to starting to uncover too. Like, what was consistent with the prior murders? Were these people that maybe to the public weren't what they seemed and weren't practicing what they preached or weren't like how doctors follow the Hippocratic Oath.
Maybe weren't
following that to the extent that they were giving the impression that they were.
Was there anything in this encounter that confused you in a not fun way, or things where you were like, that, like, or like even like a little plot hole you may have noticed in the makeup of this, or even some lingering mysteries that you still haven't maybe uncovered or that your characters would.
Yeah, I don't think so. I think the only thing that you know, like, kind of from the, almost like if I was playing a video game or something like that, I think the only thing that I would have liked to have done maybe would have been to check out the previous investigations. Yeah. To follow up with things there, like when you found the saffron scent. Mm-hmm. To see if that was something that lingered. But again, we were already pretty sure that it was the same on sub. But.
And definitely within the scope of like just what this podcast is, right. It's like you can't be like jumping around. This is something you can drop into your campaign, and it's like, yes. Yeah, of course you'd be able to go back to that.
It was a it was a fantastic like prologue. Mm-hmm. It was like a perfect prologue. Yeah. We had a few different areas to explore. I guess it would have been cool. Like, what else was in the alley?
Nothing.
No. Oh, okay. Yeah. So it's just not okay.
I think that's one thing that's sometimes very important as a DM. Like, sometimes you can feel kind of pressured
to have something.
There's everywhere. Always something right. everywhere. They right. look there. There has to be something. But I think it makes right. it more significant for when you do find things.
Right.
If there are areas that are like, nope, no clues there.
And kind of makes it realistic as well. You know, that adds a sense of reality.
So then presumably, like, because that was one of the most fun things, like mapping out how this murder happens with magic. Because I really wanted there to be magic involved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do like that idea. Like, well, when there's magic is a great way to... you don't have to climb out a window if you can misty step. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
And, like, understanding that, which I wonder... Like, for me, I found it really helpful that I've been playing for a long time. Right. I've played spellcasters. I know what spells exist. But I'm sure that was maybe a little...
It was a little... Like, to me, it seemed almost very convenient. But at the same time, it was like... I love the fact that Michael played a druid, because I also got to experience the shape-shifting element and see how that could affect a campaign or a story in one way or another. Let me put it this way. I think that this was a great like baseline story, though, because at no point was I confused or at no point did I feel like I wasn't educated enough or couldn't figure out like something that I felt like maybe I didn't understand fully with you guys being here. Again, it was really cool that Michael just so happened to play a druid and we could shapeshift, so I got to see some magical components as well, which is really cool.
Yeah.
One thing that you all didn't latch onto, Teazmo was one of them. Mm-hmm. The other was the giant desert wasp venom that was inside of the corpse. And there was also like a blow dart needle that could have been found with a high enough investigation check.
Okay. So he was those were the puncture wounds. So I didn't end up rolling a high enough.
And you would have known that giant desert wasp venom is known for its paralyzing effects, which can last for upwards of an hour.
Oh, so he was paralyzed and beaten and stabbed.
Right.
Oh, that's
what a way to go. What a way to go.
So he was alive when all of that was like happening.
He was alive and like tortured.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay. Yeah. I was going to say, so why was the poison left there then? Was that a concoction that Marcel had already made, or was that intentionally left there by the perpetrator?
I think in my mind of it, it was something that the serial killer and or assassin, whatever you want to call it, had brought with them, and it was just, you know, like, you can't, you kill a guy, you're not gonna suck all the poison out of his body.
Right, you're
probably gonna, like, leave something, because that was another thing, because I was thinking, like, there has to be a complication, and that's what Darren was, that's what the lad was.
Yeah.
He was someone that complicated the plan, whatever the plan the serial killer had.
Yes.
He wanted, like, Darren was, not part of the plan.
Yes.
Yeah. It was fun to have someone to engage with socially too, so we could get that questioning aspect of it too.
Yeah. It also kind of gave you a very obvious first step as well. Like, you could do your initial investigation, but it gave you someplace to go right away where, okay, at the very least, I know that I'm going to get some piece of important information from this individual. Whether you know it now or know it later, or come to find out later that something that he said was valuable. Yeah. But that was really cool too, having someone right away to go and question.
What did you think? Your first time playing?
It really makes me like, man, this is such a small, microscopic piece of what D&D is. Mm-hmm. And like, now I feel like if we were to ever do this again, or if I found a group, I would be, now I've experienced it, but now it's almost more excitement to do something like this again.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas it's not excitement because it's new. It's excitement because it's like, oh, what else is here? Like, what might another campaign look like? What would playing a different character look like? What would playing in like a bigger group of people look like, right?
Because it plays so many factors into it.
Yeah.
I guess this comes to the end of our podcast here, where we decide if this encounter we want to loot it or boot it. Loot it means you wanna take this, put it in your game, or experience it again. Boot it, get out of here. I could do without it. Needs to go get some rework done. So
I would absolutely vote for loot it. I think it's something that you could really, really add some creativity. And a novel element to pretty much any campaign. A murder mystery is fucking cool. It's really cool. And the interactivity, I think, it's very different than I think a lot of other campaigns would go based on what you're saying.
Yeah.
To me, it's a really solid foundation for what could just in and of itself be a really cool murder mystery or a smaller piece to a much bigger, grander puzzle.
Yeah.
So definitely a loot vote for me.
Yeah, definitely loot for me. That was so much fun, and just being able to pick up all the different clues. Thank you, Diego, for creating a really fun encounter.
Thank you.
I'm also inspired to do a detective druid character because I
realized
it was so much fun, and it would almost be interesting to do like a or a spy who's trying to hide the fact that they are a druid so that they can...
Oh!
Why don't anyone else to know yet.
Yeah, like, I don't know, it kind of inspired me to think more of this, like, I've always loved druids, but I've never really thought of that detective druid character.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
But actually it works pretty well.
It's actually cool. There's this other podcast, I've shared it with you, Michael, Dispel Magic. Great guys, great podcast. Every episode they look at a different facet of magic in D&D, usually spells, and kind of talk about the world-building implications for it. One of the ones they talked about was Speak with Animals.
Yes.
That's a really great episode to listen to. They also did a great one on Speak with Dead. But yeah, that would have had a whole... If y'all had had access to that spell, that would have, you know, added a whole other
then we
dimension.
Reanimate the body.
Yeah,
and
you could have a full-blown question check with Marcel, which would be really cool. Mm.
Thank you so much for joining us, Zach,
in
the Dungeon Busters Lab. You heard it here, folks. Fantasy CSI. Loot it. Put it in your games. And have fun with it. I think it can be a really great, like, change of pace for, like, if you're having, like, a lot of,
absolutely,
like, fights and action and whatnot, mm-hmm, take it down a gear. Make it slower. Switch up the pacing. Introduce some mystery into your games. And hopefully something here you folks learned and can incorporate at your tables.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, couldn't agree more. Not agree more.
Thank you, Zach. Any last words, Michael?
Hope you're enjoying the podcast and tune in next time.
All right.
For Dungeon Busters.
Dungeon Busters!